The financial system is not as strong as they make it seem. Corporations can indefinitely postpone losses, making themselves look more reasonable on paper. But eventually something will break down. For financial establishments, the risk is extremely high to the entire system, so they are nationalized, bailed out, or dismantled. This goes on in all countries because they essentially operate with the same strategies. Today we'll look at what's happening in China. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. I had touched on this issue previously in another video at the end of the video, but I wanted to highlight it, bring it up front here, cover it more in depth, and then get into the issues that are present in China today. I've done all kinds of videos about the situation in China, whether it's their shadow banking. We've got $32 trillion sitting in the shadows, and this here isn't being understood as of the actual risk that's involved, but look at it for what it is and understand that this could in fact create a domino effect that has a dramatic impact on valuations of companies that are in China, and then that spreads out throughout the entire world. We've got problems, and I wanted to highlight them in this video today. The Chinese government's first seizure of a bank in more than two decades reverberated through markets for a second day, driving up funding costs for smaller lenders and adding pressure to shares that already trade at rock-bottom valuations. In this particular index, these Chinese banks are set for their biggest monthly loss this year after the regulators assumed control of Baoshan Bank. Apparently, they had serious credit risks. And you're thinking to yourself, it's probably a small company. It probably was one of those little known corporations that was rated terribly. And so it happens all the time. In fact, I just showed you a video recently that was listing the FDIC website had 555 failed institutions in the United States since the year 2000. So all of these financial establishments, the banks, can fail at any time. Oftentimes, as I said in the introduction, you have a bailout, you have some sort of dismantling of the company, you have a nationalization. It depends on the country, depends on what the problems are. In this case here, you had the government coming in and actually taking over. Policymakers on Tuesday injected more cash into the banking system. Obviously, they need to do this to keep it liquid, to make sure that things stay afloat when the problems get very heavy, because if they don't, the whole system's gonna fail. This is a fraud. But anyway, let's continue on. The fall of Baoshan has its roots in the off-loan book transactions that China's small banks use to work around the rules that restrict them from lending to weak borrowers. So how do you get people to, you know, take out loans for houses and for other things? Well, you have to sidestep all the rules. And of course, there are an infinite amount of ways that corporations can do this. This happens to be one example. But if you look around in your country, I'm sure there's a way. Now, you might not be able to go to the big banks and get yourself a loan in a traditional sense, but there are always going to be ways for you to get money. You can get a second loan, a third loan, and they're willing to give you anything today. You can use anything as collateral. You can use your stocks as collateral. You can use practically anything that we've seen. And unfortunately, even car loans are being used. This problem, and unfortunately today, this problem is only getting worse. The rules need to be tighter. They need to create more ways for people to borrow less, not more. So there's more on that here. I just wanted to touch on something that's very important right at the top here. China's central bank injected a net amount of $150 billion throughout the open market operations. Now, of course, this year doesn't compare to what we've seen from the Federal Reserve when you factor in the exchange rate here, but it's important. On one day, they injected this much money in here, and obviously doing the same exact method that the Federal Reserve does, that the other central banks do, open market operations. They keep the market liquid when people are running scared. This is a very difficult process for them to do when everybody's rushing to the exit, but certainly they do so. Open market operations, you have to understand, this is the way that they manipulate interest rates as well. When they engage in this, guess what? They have to print money out of thin air, and they provide that to the market as liquidity. This here cannot be done without creating a long-term long-term problem, but it's always about the short-term fix, the short-term solution, and every central bank does the same thing. In the second last paragraph here, they're basically just mentioning a couple of the financial institutions, one down 27%, another down 36%. So obviously this sector has really taken it hard this year, even though if you look at it, yes, it's come off the peak, but generally when you look from the beginning of the year up until present, most markets around the world have been performing well. But of course that doesn't factor in the previous quarter, but just looking at it from the beginning of the year up until present, they should be up. There's really no excuse at this point. Then this article here is one of those that are trying to calm the flames. They're trying to ensure that the panic doesn't spread. Mutual funds exposure to Baosheng Bank, a private bank that regulators took over on Friday, is likely limited. This part here is very important. If we go to the middle of the page, money market funds have also been constrained by regulations restricting their holding of assets from institutions rated below AAA. Baosheng Bank was rated AA+. Now, of course, there are these different ratings, different agencies. All of these are not necessarily something that makes sense to people when they're just looking at it, like what is AAA, what is AA+. Each one has a different story here. But all I'm trying to show you with this is that it's not one of these junk rated companies, all right? It's not the biggest in the world, that's for sure, very far from it. But when you see a company like this that could fall from the very top, you have to wonder how it goes from being something that is upheld by so many people and falls down rapidly. This here could happen to any institution. Obviously, when it's really big, then it impacts more people. Think of a company like Deutsche Bank. This here should be worrisome to a lot of individuals, but it doesn't seem to be. Even though it continues to fall to record lows all the time, this isn't really being understood as of the actual impact it has. And why? Because of the derivative products that sit behind it. Just below that, we are seeing that regulators will guarantee at least 70% of the interbank debts of over 50 million and 80% of the deposits owed to the corporate creditors. I just wanted to cover that because every time there's a bank failure or anything like this, it's very dependent on that particular situation. Always different rules, always different actions. This article here out of Asia Times is basically just covering the same information, but I wanted to give you it from a different source, just looking into how this is affecting the actual banks that have nothing to do with Baosheng Bank. I just wanted to give you the idea that there's always contagion. So you might think, well, it's that bank, that they have a problem, not the bank I'm with, or, you know, the investment institution, you know, that investment institution, not this investment institution, but it doesn't work like that, especially because of the derivative products. So I just wanted to show you this article to mention that. There's a lot to discuss here, but I really just wanted to focus on the chart on the left-hand side. Medium-sized banks, which mainly include joint stock banks, are the most leveraged among Chinese banks. So China's banks' credit-to-deposit ratio, this has risen quite a bit here. Just to give you an idea, the lowest one on this list is over 100%. When you look at medium-sized banks, 132%. Just wanted to show you that. On the right-hand side, you're just getting the data, basically breaking it all down of their liabilities of the different types of banks here. This is a chart which compares China banks' liabilities to US bank liabilities, and obviously in the US, it's insanely huge. However, in China, it exceeds that by far, and the growth has been unprecedented from the financial crisis to the present. Of course, this is priced in US dollars, so the information that we're seeing here is always fluctuating depending on their exchange rate, but I just wanted to show you the difference in between the two. That's really all I'm trying to show. Jamie Dimon warns that the US-China trade fight becoming a real issue that could deter investment. So we've gone beyond what we had seen before. Okay, they're having a little tit for tat, they're having this back and forth, the rhetoric, the saber rattling, and then you have this actual continuous, constant, never-ending fight between both sides, and it is even getting the attention of Jamie D. Trade has gone from being a skirmish to being far more important than that. If this goes south in a bad way and you have other surprises, that could be part of the thing that changes confidence, changes people's willingness to invest. Already we've seen a little bit of hesitation, but the market usually turns itself around and comes back up. We had completely ignored all of the risks prior to this issue anyway, but we'll see what happens as the next couple weeks come on, because they have already shown their fear. And actually, just today as I record this video, which is on Tuesday, essentially they had thought, well, you know what, we are scared today. And then tomorrow they're going to think, well, you know what, we're not scared. And it just keeps going up and down. An under-the-radar way to measure economic growth in China is painting a bleak picture. Diesel demand in China fell 14% and 19% in March and April respectively, reaching levels not seen in a decade. This data comes from Wells Fargo, and essentially what they're trying to show you is that you can't look at the typical economic indicators like GDP, because oftentimes these are falsified, these are padded to make themselves look better. So if you look at all of these underlying type of things, what they call under-the-radar ways, that gives us an interesting look at the ability to measure, and it gives us an interesting outlook on the Chinese economy. I'm going to end the video there. If you found it informative, please give me a thumbs up. When you give me a like on this video, you're supporting me, supporting this channel. So I do appreciate that very much. If you want to see any particular type of content, you got to leave that in the comments. Make sure you're always letting me know what you want to see. I'm trying to bring all different subjects, all different countries, and show you the data, which is generally not touched on in the mainstream media. So please always let me know. If you want the financial education you were not taught in school, these two books have everything you need from top to bottom, A to Z, foundation, the history, reducing your expenses, self-sufficiency. I talk about China in these two books. I talk about the US, I talk about the IMF, and so much more. Check them out at the link in the description if you want the audiobook that's available at themoneygps.com. If you want to know about what's happening in the real economy, the real deal, then you got to watch this video. Click on it and I will see you there.